Well, good morning.
Hey.
How many of you like food?
Woohoo!
Well, almost every hand went up. How many of you then like to eat that food?
Oh.
Okay. Well, I'm not much of a cook, but I know that there are recipes that you can get that will help create some delicious food for us to consume. And so I Googled this week, like outrageous or kind of weird food items, okay, recipes. And so I'm going to put some recipes up here. I'm going to see if you can guess what the food is that comes out of this. All right, so the first one here. Okay, it takes 2 sticks of butter, 2 ounces of cream cheese, salt and pepper, a cup of flour, 1 egg, breadcrumbs, and peanut oil. Any thoughts as to what that would be? Next slide. It is fried butter balls. That sound appetizing? I can feel a heart attack coming on just speaking the word, right? All right, the next one is a pint of vanilla ice cream, cocoa powder, whipped topping, yellow frosting, pistachios. You get this. Baked potato ice cream. Nobody's going to Culver's and saying, hey, where's my baked potato ice cream? All right, the last one. Stick of butter, 3 slices of bacon, brown sugar. Heaven. Candied bacon butter.
Wow.
See, Caleb's not in here now. He missed it. So he would have loved this. Butter and bacon, right? But again, unless you're a cardiac doctor, you know, a cardiologist, you probably shouldn't be eating all that stuff, right? I mean, anything that requires like 2 or 3 whole sticks of butter, kind of got to push that away, right? Well, anyway, recipes are important to us, right? Because we like to eat. And recipe, what it does is it takes individual items and it brings it together, okay? It takes individual items, some of which, if you were to eat by themselves, they'd make you throw up because they taste so awful, right? But you mix them into the recipe, and out comes this wonderfully delicious food that we love and enjoy and need for sustenance. Well, in our country today, we're enduring the time in which we are witnessing our country and our nation turn away from God. We have seen over the last several years laws on relationships that are contrary to God's word. We are told what we can say and what we can't say depending on the situation and the place that we find ourselves. We see the elevation of all faiths, of being equal in status. And the thought of us being a Christian nation is just that. It's a distant memory. It's a thought. Because it's not reality anymore. We live in a country where words like tolerance and pluralism are bandied about more often than almost anything else. In a nation where there is no absolute right or wrong, it seems. And so as we embrace this election season, we do so with a sense of uncertainty and fear and perhaps even dread. But what I want us to see today is that there is a recipe that God has given us in His Word that will help us, you and I, as God's people, as disciples of Jesus, that will help us to handle this time of year and the election process in a Christ-like way. And that perhaps, who knows, God will take that and enable our country to flourish once again, to experience the blessings flowing from the hand of God. So if you would, turn with me to the book of 2 Chronicles, or open up your app on your phone or your iPad to 2 Chronicles chapter 7. We're going to read verses 11 through 16 today. But know that 17 through 22 is the continuation of this, and the plan as of right now, the optimal phrase being as of right now, being that we'll finish this up next week, okay, as we look at a different aspect then of how we should be living during this election season. But today we're going to look at verses 11 through 16. When Solomon had finished the temple of the Lord at the royal palace and had succeeded in carrying out all he had in mind to do in the temple of the Lord and in his own palace, the Lord appeared to him at night and said, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people, if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from them and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there. These verses take place during God's second visit, if you will, to Solomon. We looked at the first visit last week, right? As Solomon was new to this king thing, and God came to him and he said, Solomon, whatever you want, I will give it to you. Okay? Just ask and I will give it to you. And Solomon, he asked for wisdom, right? He asked for a discerning heart so that he'll be able to make right decisions and know between right and wrong. And God, who was so impressed with this, looked at Solomon and said, Solomon, I'll give you wisdom and discerning heart. Nice request. And because of that, I'm going to give you all the other stuff you didn't ask for. I'll give you riches and honor, and I'll give you long life. Here, in 2 Chronicles 7, Solomon has just completed building the temple. Now, if you're familiar with Chronicles and with what's going on here at this time, you'll know that David, Solomon's father, was the one who wanted to build a temple for God. David was living in his lush palace, and the Ark of the Covenant, what represented God to the people, was living under a tent. And David looked at it and he said, I feel bad that I'm living in this beautiful place, and God basically is living in a tent. I want to build a temple for God to live in. And God looked at David and said, David, thank you for the thought, but you're not the one to do that. Your son, Solomon, will be the one to build a temple for me. And that's what Solomon did. As we come to chapter 7, we find that the earlier verses describe the consecration, the dedication of the temple. Solomon had completed it. And the first part of chapter 7 is kind of like this worship service honoring the completion of the temple. And as God comes to Solomon, he has two purposes for this particular visit. The first is that he's accepting the temple as his place of residence among his people. All right, he comes to Solomon and he says, Solomon, thank you for the temple. I accept it. That's where I'm going to dwell among you. That's where I will live. I will put my name upon this place and I will live there. Now, we're familiar with this because of the tent of meeting from earlier in the Old Testament and from the tabernacle, that there was to be a physical location for God to live among his people. Now this sounds kind of foreign to us today because we don't have that. And the reason we don't have that is because we are the temple of God. Right? We are the ones who, when we make that profession of faith in Christ as Lord and Savior, that God, in the form of the Holy Spirit, indwells us. So that God literally lives now within you and me. Paul refers to this when he says that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So that we don't have to go to a specific place, a specific room, a specific building in order to meet with God. God is always with us, and wherever we go, God goes. And so this idea of there being a dwelling place for God sounds somewhat odd to us. But that's the story behind it, is that God, at that point, without the Holy Spirit being present, there was a spot for God to be and to be represented among his people, and he would go and he would meet with them. And here, God is saying, Solomon, thank you for the temple. I accept that as my home. I will live there. People will come and worship me there. And this is where sacrifices will be offered to me. So that's the first reason that he comes. The second reason that he comes is that he then offers a preemptive warning to Solomon to ultimately tell the people. He says, Solomon, when times get hard for the people, Solomon, when there is no rain, Solomon, when there's a plague in the land, Solomon, when there's locusts all over the place, Solomon, when people are wanting to turn their back on me, this is what you are to do. And he shares with him verse 14. Solomon, here's the recipe that you are to put into place. Here's the recipe that the people are to follow. Now, the preemptive warning then comes after that, and what we'll look at more in depth next week, because then he says, but Solomon, if you and the people should choose to do something else, be prepared, because you will not like what comes your way. And so he's offering a warning to Solomon and to the people that they need to do what God is instructing them to do, or there will be consequences that they will be forced to live through. Today, we're going to look at this recipe for success that God gives to Solomon, God gives to the people of Israel, and ultimately that God gives to us. And it comes in verse 14. In one of the most well-known verses of the Bible, God gives these four responses, or these four actions that we, his people, are to take in order to help save their nation, and then for us to help save our nation. The first is that we are to humble ourselves. As God is speaking to Solomon, he says, if my people who are called by name will humble themselves. Right? So the first step in saving the nation, in helping our country, is to invoking God's blessing, is that we need to practice humility. Now, let's think about us as Americans in our country. We typically aren't the most humble of people, right? I mean, think about it. We think of ourselves as the big, bad U.S. of A., right? We are the people who have worked so hard and pulled ourselves up by our own bootstraps. We are the only superpower in the world. Right? Not words of humility. But the Bible teaches humility. We are told that God desires a humble person, a humble heart, a humble spirit. Peter tells us in 1 Peter 5 that God opposes the proud, but he raises up the humble. That God wants humble people who have right priorities and who look at the world in the right, correct way. The word used for humble is kana, K-A-N-A, and it means to bend the knee, to bring down low, to subdue, or to put oneself under another's authority. Therefore, to humble ourselves is literally to bend our knees before God in submission, as a subject would to the king. Right? God looks at Solomon and he says, Solomon, you understand this. You are the king of these people. You know how they practice humility with you. They come before you, and before they do anything else, they bow in your presence because you are an authority over them. Solomon, this is what you're all to do for me. Because ultimately, I am the king. So when you come into my presence, you are to bow your knee. You are to subdue yourself. You are to recognize that you are that I am an authority over you. You see, during this campaign season, we have seen every candidate state what they are going to do, right? We have heard of their platform. We have heard them say, I will do this, and I won't do that, and I promise this, and I promise that. They promote themselves as the answer to our problems. And God and faith rarely, if ever, enter the conversation. You see, in speaking like that, those are words of pride, not humility. And so often we buy into the rhetoric that we look to them as the solution because we're afraid there's no other option. And when we place too much faith in a candidate, or in their political position, or their political party, we're not practicing humility. We're practicing pride because we're continuing to say, this human has the answers, and we keep God at arm's length. And so God said to humble yourselves. To Solomon, he said, if my people will humble themselves. Notice that word, themselves, or think of it in terms of humbling ourselves. God is telling us, I will not force this on you. Now that phrase, force this, I'll come back to in a minute. But what he's saying is, it is your choice. It is your decision. You must decide for yourself if you are going to humble yourself before God. Because, going back to the forced thing, there might come a time, probably will come a time, when God will force humility upon us, but the outcome will not be good, it will be bad. That's what he's saying in these verses. He's saying, look, Solomon, I'm giving everyone a chance. Humble yourself willingly and good will come. Continue to be prideful, and then I'll have to force humility upon you, and the consequences will not be good. So he's saying the choice is up to us. Humble yourself. The second thing that he says is pray. Now, this is probably the part of the recipe that we're most familiar with, right? Whenever we think about praying, whenever we talk about praying, we seem to run to this verse, right? We pull that one out, maybe because it's easier, I don't know, it's easy to say a prayer, not so easy to humble myself. Okay? But in any case, what God is saying to Solomon is this. Solomon, when life gets hard, Solomon, when the rain stops, Solomon, when the crops aren't growing, Solomon, when you're wondering where your next meal is coming from, Solomon, when you're unsure about who's going to be in the White House on November 9th, Solomon, when all this stuff's going on, come to me. Talk to me. Be with me. The Hebrew word that he uses for pray is halal. And it's got two kind of distinct meanings that I found this week. One of them is kind of the standard for prayer. You know, we're to intercede on people's behalf. We're to talk to God. We're to supplicate, which is a big fancy word just meaning we're to offer our needs to Him. Right? All those kinds of things that we normally associate with prayer. We're to intercede then and pray as the people of God for our elected people, for the candidates running, all that stuff. We're to pray for our country. We are to be intercessors before God on their behalf. That we, as the people of God, as people of prayer, are to go to the throne of God and lay our needs before Him and to pray that God would do a great work in them and through them. But the other meaning of halal that struck me as odd was it means or can mean to judge. And I thought about that, I'm thinking, okay, how does that fit with prayer? And I'm still working this out, but the thought that I have is this. That when we pray, we are presenting, or part of our prayer is presenting our needs, our requests to God, right? In essence, we're lifting up what's on our heart and we're placing it at God's feet. And when we do that, then we have two choices. One is we lay it at God's feet and we leave it with God when we're done praying and we trust that He is better, stronger, smarter to handle those situations. We call upon Matthew 11 where He says, give me your burdens and I'll carry them for you. We do all of that and we leave it there. Or the second thing that we do is we unburden ourselves. We say, Lord, help me, Lord, help me, Lord, help me. And then we say, amen. We get up from our prayer time. And we say, okay, God, I'll take these back. Thanks. And we don't trust Him. And we trust ourselves. We say, God, you know, I'll take care of this. I'll handle it. And so what I'm thinking is that in that situation, we are judging between two options. We are trying to determine which is the best option, to unbear ourselves and leave it with God and trust Him, or to unbear ourselves, pick it back up, and not trust God, and trust ourselves. And what God is saying here is, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, if they will leave their stuff with me, I'll carry it for them. I will see them through it. I am the best option. Through prayer, we are displaying our dependence upon someone greater than ourselves. By praying, we recognize that real change in our country only comes through changed hearts. And we understand that no human candidate can change the human heart. No law is going to change the human heart. Only God can do that. And so, our last Sunday in this series is going to be the Sunday right before the election. And so we are going to spend this time praying. Now, I expect one of two reactions. Yay, that guy won't be talking. Or, okay, I've got 3 or 4 weeks to plan something for that Sunday. I hope that you all plan to be here so that we can come together and pray to our God for our country. All right, the third ingredient in the recipe is seek. Okay, so first we humble ourselves, then we pray, and then after that God said, and if they would seek my face. The word used here means to search out or to beg, to desire, to beseech. Okay, think of it in this term, in this way. If you've ever been in a department store and you had your little child with you and you turned this way for a second and when you turned back, they weren't there, okay? You were doing some seeking, right? Your heart was doing one of these, and you were turning everything over. You were knocking old ladies off their walkers. You were going, doing whatever you needed to do to find them, right? God's saying, that's the way I want you to be with me. Maybe not knocking old ladies off their walkers, but He wants us to be seeking after Him in that way. That He should be our number one priority, our deepest desire, the one that we search for with all of our hearts. Now, how might we go about doing this? Well, first thing is to know and obey God's word. We want to seek Him. We have to know who He is and know what He's calling us to. Now, I want you to notice something, if you haven't already. As we've been going here these last several weeks, this idea of God's word and knowing it and obeying it keeps popping its head up, doesn't it? Interesting, huh? That maybe this book, and not just reading it, but actually knowing it and living it out, maybe it's kind of important. Maybe God was right when He said, hey, that should be the foundation for life. That's why it keeps coming up. Because it is in everything that we are about and do. See, our nation is not going to change until people of the book live like people of the book. The second thing that we can do is trust Him and not methods. We talked about this in depth last week. But when we are seeking God's face, we place our faith and our trust in Him and not in a candidate and not in their platform. No president, no elected anybody will ever be our Savior. And to view them as such puts anxiety and worry on us, and we lose trust in God, and we begin to seek them and not God. So we need to trust Him and not trust anything else. And the final thing to help us seek Him is to worship Him and not worship other things. To worship Him is to give Him honor and worth and to exalt Him to the rightful place that He deserves. Because that gives Him worth that He deserves. And when we're worshiping Him, we're less likely to worship them. And when we worship them, that's where we tend to put our trust in them and not in Him. And finally, the fourth ingredient in the recipe is to repent. God told Solomon that after his people humble themselves and pray and seek his face, the next thing that they are to do is to turn from their wicked ways. The word for turn means to retreat, to withdraw, to turn away. When we discipline our children or grandchildren, we want them to own up to what they did wrong, right? We want them, we say, do you understand what you did wrong? And then we have them repeat it back to us a lot of times, right? So that we know, they know what they did wrong. Okay? A lot of no's in there, maybe confused, but... Okay, and then we say, okay, here are the consequences, plus, I don't want you to do that ever again. Because we don't want them to get caught, to get punished, and say, that wasn't too bad. I'll just go back and do this again. Okay? But have you noticed that that's how we act a lot of times? That's how our country has acted a lot of times. Because we have to be honest with ourselves. We have to admit that as individuals and as a country in general, we have screwed up. We have sinned. We have disobeyed. We've turned our backs on God. And while it is good to confess what we have done, God demands that there be more. And that's what his words to Solomon indicate. Saying, Solomon, he says, Solomon, it's not, notice he didn't say, if my people will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and seek forgiveness. But he said that they would turn from their wicked ways. Because it wasn't enough, it isn't enough just to ask for forgiveness. We must be people of repentance. Paul talked about this in the book of Romans. Evidently, there were some people who said, hey, this grace of God thing, it's awesome. I can do whatever I want to. Peek my head and say, hey, God, will you forgive me? All right, great. And then go back and do whatever I wanted to do. And Paul said, whoa, time out. That's not how this thing works. Okay, that's not what this is about. If you think that way, if you live that way, then you are abusing God's grace. You don't understand God's grace. Because God's grace is given to us so that we would appreciate who He is and we would want to be more like Him, not just use Him as some Buddha that we rub His belly and get all feel better and feel good feelings about. And then keep doing what we're doing. That's not how it works. This is what God showed Israel. It's what we'll look at more next week. That he warned them that if they continued disobeying him, he would leave them to the outcome of their decisions. He would leave them to the consequences of their sin. We as a country are a blessed country. But I believe in order for that to continue, we, the church, the people of God, need to stand up and lead us to the throne of God in repentance and in turning from our wicked ways. Because until then, I think God will continue to limit His blessings upon us as a nation. But that there will come a day when He will lift His hands and He will stop the blessing altogether. In closing, I want you to notice the end of verse 14. Because after God gives this recipe, then He then gives the result, right? Kind of like the here's the fried butter balls kind of thing, okay? This is what you get, he said, when you live this way. And the first is that he said, you'll be forgiven. God said, I will forgive you. I promise that this is what I will do. I will forgive you if you seek it. If you live this way, I will forgive you. I have not abandoned you. I have not given up on you. You see, when we practice those ingredients, when we live that way in this world, we gain a deeper understanding of just how much we've been forgiven. And when we understand how much we've been forgiven, it enables us to forgive others more readily. You know why? Because when we see what someone's done to us, we realize how much it pales in comparison to how we sinned against God. And now he was so readily available and ready to forgive us. How can I hold back forgiveness from some little, pesky little nonsense? And as we then are able to forgive others, that's part of then the second reward that he gives us, which is that he'll heal the nation. Right? That as we live out these ingredients and as we forgive others, as, because we have been forgiven, it begins the healing process in our country and in our nation. Again, the healing, our country bouncing back, our country being great again, doesn't happen through any human. Doesn't matter what political party they're in, it's not going to happen through them. It happens by the people of God being the people of God. It happens by us being a vehicle to allow God be God. Now, I'm no psychic. I have no idea what God's ultimate plan will be for us as a nation. It might be to restore us. It might be to make us great again. It might be to make us who we once were. But it might not. It might not. It might be to lift his hands off. I don't know. That's all for him to decide and to worry about. What I do know is that God, who has loved us so much, has said, here's what I want for you. Here's the recipe to get the end result that you desire. Humble yourselves. Pray to me. Seek my face, no other. And turn away from all that wickedness in your life, individually and as a nation. And I do know that when we live like that, there is no telling what God will do. Let's pray. Father God, it is easy to hear that this is what we're supposed to do. It is hard to live it out. And so, Lord, as your temples, as the dwelling, as the vessels in which you dwell, through that power, help us to live as humble, prayerful, seeking, repentant people. So that you can do what only you can do. Remind us that our health and our future doesn't rest on any human. It rests in your hands. And for that, we are grateful. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together as we sing our music songs.